today I have the pleasure of meeting Head of Hospitality at Northampton College, Mike Coppock. How do you do?
Hi Gordon, good seeing
you. Pleasure to meet you.
Thanks for coming down.
Yeah, well I did promise to get back after the adventures of our annual awards dinner that we brought here. Yeah. How did that work for you guys?
It was a great night actually. I mean, it was a long day. It was like being back in industry.
Yeah,
I think we were on from 7 o'clock until 2:30 the following morning. But yeah, it was a really good day. I mean, the students loved it. They're still talking about it now.
Some of those youngsters would have been in school sort of earlier that year.
Yes.
And for them to be surrounded by, you know, the great and good of the industry would have been a real buzz, I guess. Yeah.
It was good. I mean, it was great to see some names. And what's interesting, of course, is we've got Great British Menu on at the moment, and some of the people that were with us in November. Obviously on the Great British Menu.
Absolutely.
And it's revitalised the buzz that was going on then, really.
Very good, very good. So, obviously, you look after you know, the hospitality department here. Mm-hmm. How is the recession impacting your ability to teach? How is the recession pressurising you? Is it making it easier? Can you just give us an overview of your view of education?
Yeah, I mean, we've got two main issues here. We run all the on-site catering on three sites, as well as the teaching and training as well. So from a finance point of view, servicing the needs of the students. I mean, we've got 4,500 students on site at the moment.
Okay.
And they all need feeding. You know, their pound's getting smaller. They haven't got quite so much money to take. So, you know, our remit is to keep the students on site. So it means we have to sort of not look at profits necessarily, but make sure that we can feed the students, give them a hearty, wholesome meal, no mm-hmm. horse, and hopefully keep them on site so they're ready for their lessons in the afternoon.
Okay.
From a teaching point of view, it's a struggle. It really is a struggle at the moment.
So is that because of the government? Is it because of why, like, your hours being cut? Like, can you give us a sort of overview of education from that perspective?
I mean, in further education, there's always change. In education, there's always change. The world changes. But we've had significant cuts over the last 4 or 5 years, not just with this government, with the previous government. Our hours have been reduced by 40-45% in 5 years. That's a significant impact. Obviously, the industry that we're supposed to be preparing the students for aren't always aware of this. And it doesn't do us any favours, really. We can't cover the range of products and the range of cooking and service that we'd like to cover. And the impact is that industry turned around and said, well, colleges are rubbish. Well, they're not rubbish. We're doing the best we can with the product that we've got, which is a lot less money and a lot less hours to teach. Something's got to go. Mm. And unfortunately, some of the skills we just can't deliver.
It's really interesting because the reason why we're talking to you today is because it's because over the last year you've opened your doors to us for our pro chef training events in which Michelin starred chefs have come along. What we found really encouraging is you've shoved your teaching staff into those environments, massively challenging, but as each one has gone by, they've become sort of industry relevant, which we don't see a great deal of. How have your guys actually found that themselves? Have they found it quite useful?
I mean, they've found it really useful. I mean, the important thing, you know, from our point of view, is we're a relatively young team, and I don't necessarily mean that in age. the issue that we have with any vocational training is we need people to do the job, to learn the business at the sharp end, and then at 35, 30, 40, to think, oh, hang on, I'd like to come and do a bit of teaching. You know, at 20 years old, I'd argue, it's no good coming to teach hairdressing, welding, car mechanics, chef training, food preparation training. You don't know enough. We're gonna throw people into a kitchen with real restaurant, with real customers, with 14 students, 12 students that have never even taken a knife out of a knife world before,
yeah,
and say, cook a full menu. It's tough, you know. So, you know, we've got an awful lot of staff that are in their 40s. There are a few that are quite old, past their 40s, but most of the guys are young. You know, they're still hungry to learn.
Yeah.
They're hungry for success, and they want to go out there and chase. And it's a great way of doing some relevant CPD. We haven't got to go far because it's coming to our doorstep. They can get some Michelin experience. Some of them really got Michelin and Rosette experience. But on our doorstep, new techniques. We have to do a lot of modern gastronomy on the qualifications now. Mm-hmm. And to send somebody off on a course, £300, £400, £500, you're losing them for a day, they're off to London, transport, it's an absolute nightmare. Yeah. So when it's on your doorstep, what better way to utilise that?
Something that I really enjoyed seeing when we had our industry awards here, you have like 10 of the best chefs in the country here. And I'm sure they won't mind me saying on camera they do come with a little bit of baggage.
Just a little bit, yes.
and the challenge really for you is to marshal them. And the only experience you have would be perhaps your memories of the industry and just how wonderfully relevant they were that night to pack them into their boxes to make sure that they did what they were expected to do. How did you find the chefs responded? Because they probably looked at you and thought, chef lecturer, like, who are you, like to tell me? But you did tell them and they did like come in line. How did that work that night?
I mean, it was an interesting concept because some of the guys came the night before, some came first thing in the morning, some came middle of the afternoon, and the varying sort of arrival times was a bit of a challenge because we couldn't have a full briefing.
Yeah.
We tried to get a briefing in where we talked about, you know, components of a dish, how long is it going to take to plate up, is there anything you want to serve at the table, do you want, you know, jokes to put your sauce on, tell me now, we can sort anything, but you need to tell me now. And most of the guys took it on board, fair play. And then, you know, a few of them like to keep a few surprises, which just causes hassles all night. But, you know, I mean, I've worked in the industry, you're used to that, and it's how you cope with it and how you deal with it. Some of the guys were absolutely fantastic. They couldn't have done any more to help the students. Others took it very much as a competition, sort of hid themselves in a way, in a corner, and weren't quite so open about sharing. But again, that was fine. If they'd have all have done that, it would have been a problem.
I don't think there's an event in the industry where that would actually put you in a position whereby you have a team of industry leaders coming into your kitchen and you don't know how the heck that's going to work out. Front of house, you've got an untested food service team. You don't know how that's going to work out. But it's a real testament to your skill and your department that you made it feel like a Park Lane our industry event that night.
But we say here quite often, we've got two training restaurants here. We've got students that rotate every week or every 2 weeks, and we have six menus running in each restaurant. I've got a brasserie, I've got a restaurant lunch, and I've got a dinner restaurant. And every week the menu changes. So our Tuesday practical is almost like a launch of a restaurant every week.
Great,
with a new group of students in the kitchen, a new group of students in the restaurant, and a new menu.
Yeah.
And everything starts from scratch with empty fridges. And at 9 o'clock we have a briefing, and at 12 o'clock we're serving customers.
Fantastic.
That's a challenge.
Yeah.
You know, it's a challenge, but it's great fun. That's how it should be.
Having worked with yourself and other colleges, despite the cuts and everything else, is that we have, there's no, you know, diminishment of quality here. You are finding the time to somehow, you know, eke out the extra hours and to get these kids inspired. But you also reach out really well to the industry as well. Can you tell us about, you know, a little bit about the industry that you reach out to?
Yeah, I mean, we do a lot of work, certainly within the county, with hotels, restaurants. We do a lot of work with the Northampton Food and Drink Awards. We were sort of very important, very involved with the setting up of that. We provide facilities, we provide venues, we provide judges. A lot of the students enter. We judge on the food produce. You know, we're a wonderful county. We've got 10, 12 microbreweries. We've got vineyards. We've got fruit juice manufacturers. We've got people that make lemon curd, pork pies, sausages, ice cream, gattos, and then we've got the big boys. You know, you've got your Weetabix, you've got your Carlsberg breweries, but there's an awful lot of small manufacturing that goes on in the county, and it's a great place to work, some wonderful food, and it's great to see some good quality artisan food still being available to the pubs and restaurants that are local.
That's absolutely fantastic. What would you say to industry that visionary dining as a business think that the industry expects every student that you teach to walk out, it should walk into a Michelin star restaurant. But the industry is a lot wider than that. What would you say to chefs in the industry who have expectations of every single student being fully capable of that level when they leave?
They need to come and visit a college. They need to understand the business that they're getting their student, their trainees from. We get calls every day, you know, oh, I need a student, I need two students, I need three students, I need somebody on work experience, I want a cheap apprentice. Come and have a look at what colleges do.
Yeah.
You know, we have a huge remit, everything from serving fish fingers in a nursery all the way up to five-star hotels and Michelin-star restaurants. We have to aim to cover everything. I would like to think that certainly the bigger colleges are aiming at a very high level. We have lots of students, we have lots of lecturers, we have lots of facilities, and we can deliver some good quality training. Other colleges don't always offer level three because they don't have the facilities or the staff skills.
No.
Some colleges, very small colleges, only offer level one. But they're all doing a good job because we all need to put people into the industry that we love. And there's a niche for everybody. We can't all turn out Michelin star chefs.
No.
You pass your driving test, you don't go and drive a Formula One car.
That's a very good analogy.
You need to learn to be a good driver, and then if you're really lucky, you may get to drive a Formula One car. But it's, you know, 0.000%, isn't it?
It is. How do you feel the apprenticeship scheme is working sort of generally in the industry and within your department?
Hospitality, I've always found a bit of a challenge. If you're in a big city, apprenticeships work quite well because you've got an awful lot of restaurants, hotels, pubs in a very short space of, you know, small demographic. In the bigger counties with not so many big towns, and we don't have big cities close to us, to get from one apprentice site to another is quite expensive because they may be a long, long way away. Some of the establishments in Northamptonshire may only have one apprentice.
Right.
If you're going to the Dorchester, you know, they may have 30 apprentices. It's easy to go and visit a big hotel and hit, figuratively speaking, 30 apprentices in one go. You can look at where they are, you look at their plans, look at what they're cooking that week, see what they've got signed off, see what they're learning, what skills they've got, and if you need to put on an extra session, you can deliver to 30 students because they're all on site. To do it to one person, it's quite tough and it works out quite expensive. So it doesn't always work. If you're in Birmingham or London, apprentices are fantastic. But if you're out in the sticks, it doesn't always work quite so well.
Okay. Just give us your views on your impression of how chefs on TV are hindering or helping the industry. What would be your view on that?
Again, the old adage, all publicity is good publicity. You know, we've got the horse scandal on at the moment. Is good publicity, any publicity good publicity? Not always the case, I think.
Yeah.
We've got some great cookery programs on telly. Sometimes it does give the wrong impression. Yes, it's great, it's sexy, it's fun, but the guys that are on telly have been doing the job for 10, 15, 20 years. They haven't left college at 19 and gone to be TV chefs. It doesn't work like that. They have to get earn their wings first, so to speak. The thing that I really liked a couple of years ago was the restaurant service program. We've been saying in the industry for years.
Yeah.
You know, what Fred Siriacs did, fantastic, you know. Lots of things about cooking, not so much on food service. If you look at, you know, Hell's Kitchen and things like that, yes, the restaurant manager comes up to the pass and has a quick word with the chef, but he's on for 30 seconds.
Yes.
The chefs are on for 55 minutes. And we need a lot more restaurant orientated to turn the restaurant side into a career rather than how it's perceived in this country, more of a part-time job.
I think Fred's doing something on the National Waiters Day, isn't he? Which
is,
I think is just, you know, a fantastic initiative. Well, thanks very much for your time.
Pleasure.
Today. What, just
pleasure.
One last thing that you probably don't expect is that we work with lots of really high quality lecturers over the year, but the reason for this interview is that we have now crowned you Chef Lecturer of the Year 2013 as a result of your unbelievable performance on the night of our industry awards, and also for the fantastic work that you've been doing with us, but also your students and the whole integration of industry within the department. Has just been awesome, really. And the prize for this, which you might not like, but anyway, is you will be invited to join our cannonball run in June.
Which is stunning.
Which you've got to keep awake for 48 hours and visit as many Michelin stars.
It'll be tough, won't it?
Sure. But I think it's Richard Axford from Kendall, he won the award this last year, so... Yeah. you can compare notes.
Marvellous, thank you very much.
And congratulations and thank you again, Mike.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks. Cheers.